Welcome to Coffee Break. How are you?
Thank you. Thank you, Brian. Very good. Thank you. I'm fine.
Yeah, have
Very
you had a good
fine.
week so far?
Yes. Yes. Sure. I'm quite okay. Thank you.
Yeah, good. Well, so I want to talk to you today about, a couple different things. But first of all, talk a little bit about ITT friction technologies. So I know ITT friction is, part of the larger, I guess, ITT Corporation.
Yeah,
So
correct.
I want to talk a little bit about, I guess, ITT friction. So can you kind of like start off by giving me a little bit of like an overview of ITT friction technologies, kind of who you are, what you do, markets you serve, that kind of stuff?
Sure, Brian. So, IT3 Friction Technology is headquartered in Italy, in north of Italy, actually. We are on the automotive business, pretty much on the all the sales channel, OE, OES, and aftermarket, but predominantly on OE. And we are by far a market leader as far as the OE European market is concerned. And we are, growing up significantly in all APAC region as well as North American region. So we have five manufacturing plants. So actually, our footprint is quite concentrated. So we have two in Italy, one in Czech Republic, one in China, and the latest one in Mexico. Latest one. So I mentioned them in a chronological order of opening, right?
So the one in Mexico, was that specifically to help serve that I guess, North American region?
Right, exactly. So the idea is that through the Italian plants, we serve all the European market. With the Chinese plant, we serve the whole APAC region. And then with the Mexico plant, we are serving actually all the North American market.
From with the pandemic that has been going on, so did you all have to shut down all of your manufacturing globally? Or, 'cause I know Italy, you guys were hit pretty hard there at one point. Or were you all able to continue to manufacture during all this?
No, actually, we went through the whole spectrum of closing, basically following one-to-one the evolution of the pandemic disease. So it means that we started to be hit in China back in February, and of course then we closed there the operations in China for a while. And then, the pandemic moved and spread to Europe first. So we had to close Italy facilities as well as Ostrava facility in Czech Republic. And then lately, we also shut down Mexican facility in Silao following this, let's say, country lockdown, which was issued up to the all May. So we had different closing in different regions for different timing. So it was quite a hectic moment, I would say.
Yeah. Now, are you all back running like normal, or are you all still kind of in the phase of, I guess, maybe trying to reopen some of these facilities?
No, actually, we are all back to work. So all our production facilities are reopened. Not all are running at full capacity, though. So, and again, here is again the same thing happening with the closing. So we are, running almost at full capacity in China. In Italy and Ostrava, we are ramping up and we are, anyway, working every day, which is already good. And in Mexico, we opened, reopened, sorry, last week. And over there also, we are ramping up to full capacity. So that is the, let's say, the good side of the coin, that we have been able to be back on track with all facilities.
Now that you're leading the Friction team, you've got, or the Friction group, you've got, you know, locations all around the world, and you've actually worked, and you worked in China for several years, Czech Republic. So I just want to kind of learn from you a little bit about maybe, like, what were some of the, is there anything that stood out that you learned as far as managing people when you worked maybe in China versus the Czech Republic to you know, even Mexico? You know, was it fundamentally the same how you manage people, or were you completely surprised on maybe how you had to go about with managing, leading, getting things done?
I think that is a good question. I'm not so sure I have a kind of good answer, but I can tell you my experience, share my experience. But first of all, I think I am lucky because I do love my job. So wherever I am, I am fine when I have my job and I can do. I would say someone can say I'm passionate for my job. I would say just a kind of personal commitment, and it's true. I'm fond of this job. I'm fond of this industry, and I'm quite okay wherever I am, providing that I have I do what I do. And so, having said that, of course there are a lot of differences in terms of cultural differences, habits, and so on between China, Czech Republic, Italy, Mexico, and so on. And I don't think there is a kind of magic recipe to make things working well on those countries. But I think there are some, I would say, common rule that I believe embrace the world. So if you are consistent and you are doing things with integrity and a lot of passion for what you are doing, eventually everywhere you can succeed, and the people is recognizing this to you. So the value of being serious, hardworking, committed to the company, doing the best that you can to succeed, and for doing the good of the company, which means also then the good of the people, of course, it's a kind of a universal value which pay off. So that is, I would say, it's the way.
Yeah, no, that makes sense too. And you, from a language, like communication, because obviously, communication is key in business and in life and anything. Did you have a hard time with like the language barrier, like when you went from one country to the next? Or, I mean, obviously you speak multiple languages, obviously. But was that an issue for you, or were you able to figure out a way to make sure that the communication was, or is still pretty strong?
The communication becomes, I would say, a barrier. The language becomes a barrier if you don't have content. So if you are not solid and you don't have the basics, then it's a problem. But if you are doing a kind of a job like mine, which is also is not really philosophy, and we were not doing too much debate about Hegel or Kant back in China in 2000, but we had to run and to and to beat up the factory and so on. So in those technical stuff, mm-hmm. I think that it's not an issue. I mean, I am quite communicative, despite the fact that I was not talking Chinese. Mm-hmm. And also in Czech Republic, honestly, I was not talking Czech, which is quite a hard language. But as I said, communication was never a problem ever in any place. So,
gotcha. What about a personal level? Did you have a hard time adapting whenever you moved from one, you know, because you went not for just a few months or a few weeks. I mean, you went for years. So did you have a hard time adjusting? Or are you
pretty adaptable?
You kind of just fit right in after a while.
Well, you know, Brian, when I was in China, I was young. I was alone. So I was 28, something like that. So no family. So it was just working and then... you know, and then rest a few hours during the night and some weekends. But then in Czech Republic, again, I went there alone, and then during that stay, I built up my family. But it was quite okay. So I think, as I said, I'm lucky because I'm a lucky guy. I love my job and I can adapt myself quite okay in different regions and so on, and I think that if you do that, as I said, with this honest approach to the life and to the work, with this commitment and focus on your job and try to do your best, knowing that anyway you are a guest where you are. Mm-hmm. And having this respect for the place where you are and the dignity of all the people that are around you, I think it's fine. It's very fine.
You know, this first half of the year has been kind of crazy for everybody globally. So, you know, businesses, operations, you know, every sector has been hit. So what are you all seeing? The second half of the year? I mean, what are you predicting? What are the challenges? I mean, what do you see happening, I guess, for the rest of 2020?
That is a $1 million question.
Yeah.
So, you know, 2020 is a completely crazy year. You know, we were hit heavily by this pandemic disease. We were not expecting that much, honestly. On the automotive business, you know, Q1 was down 23% in light vehicle production, I mean.
So is that before? So Q1 was down already before the hit?
Right. 23% versus previous year, right? And it was already hit only for the China portion, because in China already started in February all this mess. Q2, which is the bottom of really what I call the Death Valley, Q2 is going to be down by roughly 50% if I look the production of vehicles in 2020 versus 2019.
I'm surprised it's only down 50%, to be honest with you.
Right?
I'm surprised it was only down 50% compared to...
This is at worldwide level. Worldwide. Of course, this 50% has different shadow severity. So April and May were the worst month ever, going from, you know, Italy minus 98% to even North America minus 85, something like that. So, and then all over the world is will be minus 50. And then Q3 and Q4, we will be only minus 11 and minus 10, making the whole year, the projection now are showing something like 20 million vehicles produce less. So now the latest projection are showing something like 67, 68 million of vehicles worldwide production versus the 88 million of 2019. So there will be a kind of a, what we call scenario late Q3 recovery, but 2020 will be hit by probably between 25 and 30% full year, right? 2019 and 2018 were already 2 years of stagnation, let's say, small reduction of volumes. Mm-hmm. So what we are seeing, personally, maybe because I am an optimistic, right? Or I try to be, because, you know, they're saying that the pessimistic is only an optimistic, well-informed. But I'm trying to be optimistic. I see that, you know, I think that April and May were really the worst, the bottom of the month. So there will be slightly...
Bounce back.
Right. The only problem is to see at with which pace there will be the recovery. That is still a question.
Yeah. So... Yeah. So what do you see 2021 then? I mean, are you seeing 2021 getting back to normal somewhat, but maybe are there other factors that are maybe cause it to be up or down in 2021?
I think I don't have the crystal ball, of course, but I think it will take probably at least a couple of years to go back, to come back to the volumes of 2019, which, by the way, they were already down volumes of 2016 and 17.
Yeah, because even regardless of the pandemic, you know, obviously from a just in general the vehicle automotive market, because of cultural changes, people maybe either driving less or maybe with electric vehicles, autonomous vehicles, or you know, whatever. You know, the way people use vehicles is changing as well. So that's also, it's obviously another way of us trying to figure out at what levels is the, you know, the automotive manufacturing going to kind of level out? You know, what number is that going to kind of be the norm now with the way people use vehicles too? So it'd be interesting to see.
Yeah.
Well, Cesare, I tell you what, man, it's been, I've had a great time on our conversation.